To worship God this morning. Let us know Him as our refuge, our strength, and our salvation. Sorry, Owen. Owen's going to chime the hour for us.
Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless His holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all His benefits. Now if you'll stand and join us, we sing hymn number 5, verses 1 through 4.
Thank you.
join our hearts in prayer. Father, we come before you this day as the sheep of your hand. We come as your people, made so in Christ Jesus. We come, Father, seeking comfort, strength, renewal, hope. We ask, Father, that you would feed us. Would feed us the words of life. We ask, Father, that you would strengthen not only our bodies, our hearts, our minds, our very souls. We ask that we would know your presence here among us this day by the work of your Holy Spirit in each of our lives. And this is our prayer together in Christ's name. Amen. Amen. The Lord greets you with these words, grace to you and peace from God our Father. And how is it that we have this grace and peace? We have it in and through the Lord Jesus Christ, who gave himself for our sins to deliver us from the present evil age. And he did this according to the will of God. It was God's will that we might know this grace and this peace, and it is to his glory forever and ever. So the Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us greet one another in the Lord.
Good morning.
How are you doing?
Song of praise. Let's stand and sing together.
Okay, Brian, keep it right.
What a mighty God he serves.
Hear the word of the Lord from Psalm 25. To you, O Lord, I lift up my soul. O my God, in you I trust. Let me not be put to shame. Let not my enemies exult over me. Indeed, none who wait for you shall be put to shame. They shall be ashamed who are wantonly treacherous. Make me to know your ways, O Lord. Teach me your paths. Lead me in your truth and teach me. For you are the God of my salvation. For you I wait all the day long. Remember your mercy, O Lord, and your steadfast love, for they have been from of old. Remember not the sins of my youth or my transgressions. According to your steadfast love, remember me, for the sake of your goodness, O Lord. Good and upright is the Lord. Therefore, he instructs sinners in the way. He leads the humble in what is right and teaches the humble his way. All the paths of the Lord are steadfast love and faithfulness for those who keep his covenant and his testimonies. For your name's sake, O Lord, pardon my guilt, for it is great. Who is the man who fears the Lord? Him will he instruct in the way that he should choose. His soul shall abide in well-being, and his offspring shall inherit the land. The friendship of the Lord is for those who fear him, and he makes known to them his covenant. My eyes are ever toward the Lord, for he will pluck my feet out of the net. Turn to me and be gracious to me, for I am lonely and afflicted. The troubles of my heart are enlarged. Bring me out of my distresses. Consider my affliction and my trouble, and forgive all my sins. Consider how many are my foes, and with what violent hatred they hate me. Oh, guard my soul and deliver me. Let me not be put to shame, for I take refuge in you. May integrity and uprightness preserve me, for I wait for you. Redeem Israel, O God, out of all his troubles. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Now we get to stand and sing hymn number 8, The Mighty Fortress is Our God.
Our God, our Lord, our Savior, 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 our Lord
go to the Lord and confess our sins together. Father, we come before you as children of grace. We come in the name of Christ Jesus, who gave himself for us, who died to deliver us from our sins, that we might know your forgiveness. As we stand before you in that grace, Father, we remain aware of our wandering hearts. Today, Father, we confess that at times we do things out of a desire to please others more than a desire to please you. And even when we disregard that people-pleasing nature that we have, we still seek to please ourselves more than you. We ask, Father, that we might have hearts that yearn, that desire to see you glorified in our words, in our actions, in our thoughts. We ask that by the power of your Spirit, you would make this a reality within us. This we pray together in Christ's name. Amen. Brothers and sisters, hear now the good news. For you did not receive the spirit of slavery to fall back into fear, but you have received the spirit of adoption as sons, by whom we cry, Abba, Father. The Spirit himself bears witness with our spirit that we are children of God. And if children, then heirs. Heirs of God and fellow heirs with Christ, provided we suffer with him, in order that we may also be glorified with him. It is through faith in Christ Jesus that you are forgiven. Thanks be to God. Knowing that grace and that love, be mindful of God's will for your lives. Bondservants, obey in everything those who are your earthly masters, not by way of eye service as people pleasers, but with sincerity of heart, fearing the Lord. Whatever you do, work heartily as for the Lord and not for men, knowing that from the Lord you will receive the inheritance as your reward. As we prepare to worship God through giving, we're going to remain seated and sing, My Worth Is Not in What I Own.
Oh, Let us pray. Lord, we have come to that time of our service when we have the wonderful opportunity to give back to you with our financial resources. We have sang praises to your name, prayed for those sins in our lives that keep us from being close to you, and read the words of your scripture. Now let us give to you with generous and thankful hearts. We pray that these offerings will benefit your work and your kingdom. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Join your hearts with me in prayer. Father, you've been speaking to us all morning, and we have been responding. Now, Father, we ask that once more you would speak to each and every one of us. We ask that you would quiet our minds. We ask that we might worship you with our ears, with our thoughts, with our hearts laid bare, and that you would speak new life to each and every one of us, that you would do a new work in our lives through your word. And this we pray in Christ's name. Amen.
Hear the word of the Lord from the Old Testament lesson, the book of Jeremiah, the very first chapter. Now the word of the Lord came to me, saying, "Before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. And before you were born, I consecrated you. I appointed you a prophet to the nation. Then I said, 'Ah, Lord God, behold, I do not know how to speak, for I'm only a youth.' But the Lord said to me, 'Do not say I'm only a youth, for to all whom I send you, you shall go. And whatever I command you, you shall speak. Do not be afraid of them, for I am with you to deliver you, declares the Lord.' Then the Lord put out his hand and touched my mouth. And the Lord said to me, 'Behold, I have put my words in your mouth. See, I have set you this day over nations and over kingdoms, to pluck up and to break down, to destroy and overthrow, to build and to plant.'" And now the epistle lesson from the first chapter of the book of Galatians. "For am I now seeking the approval of man or of God? Or am I trying to please man? If I were still trying to please man, I would not be a servant of Christ. For I would have you know, brothers, that the gospel that was preached by me is not man's gospel. For I did not receive it from any man, nor was I taught it, but I received it through a revelation of Jesus Christ. For you have heard of my former life in Judaism, how I persecuted the church of God violently and tried to destroy it. And I was advancing in Judaism beyond many of my own age among my own people. So extremely zealous was I for the traditions of my fathers. But when he who had set me apart before I was born, and who called me by his grace, was pleased to reveal his son to me in order that I might preach him among the Gentiles, I did not immediately consult with anyone, nor did I go up to Jerusalem to those who were apostles before me. But I went away into Arabia and returned again to Damascus. Then after 3 years, I went up to Jerusalem to visit Cephas and remained with him 15 days. But I saw none of the other apostles except James, the Lord's brother. And what I'm writing to you before God, I do not lie. Then I went into the regions of Syria and Cilicia, and I was still unknown in person to the churches of Judea that are in Christ. They were only hearing it said, 'He who used to persecute us is now preaching the faith he once tried to destroy.' And they glorified God because of me." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Let's stand for the reading of the gospel. Hear now the word of the Lord from the gospel according to Matthew, the 10th chapter. The words of Christ: "Behold, I am sending you out as sheep in the midst of wolves. So be wise as serpents and innocent as doves. Beware of men, for they will deliver you over to courts and flog you in their synagogues, and you will be dragged before governors and kings for my sake, to bear witness before them and the Gentiles. When they deliver you over, do not be anxious how you are to speak or what you are to say, for what you are to say will be given to you in that hour. For it is not you who speak, but the Spirit of your Father speaking through you. Brother will deliver brother over to death, and the father his child, and children will rise against parents and have them put to death. And you will be hated by all for my name's sake, but the one who endures to the end will be saved. When they persecute you in one town, flee to the next. For truly I say to you, you will not have gone through all the towns of Israel before the Son of Man comes. A disciple is not above his teacher, nor a servant above his master. It is enough for the disciple to be like his teacher, and the servant like his master. If they have called the master of the house Beelzebub, how much more will they malign those of his household? So have no fear of them, for nothing is covered that will not be revealed, nor hidden that will not be known. What I tell you in the dark, say in the light, and what you hear whispered, proclaim on the housetops. And do not fear those who kill the body but cannot kill the soul. Rather fear him who can destroy both soul and body in hell. Are not two sparrows sold for a penny? And not one of them will fall to the ground apart from your Father. But even the hairs of your head are all numbered. Fear not, therefore, for you are of more value than many sparrows. So everyone who acknowledges me before men, I will also acknowledge before my Father who is in heaven. But whoever denies me before men, I will also deny before my Father who is in heaven. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. You may be seated. We spend a great deal of our lives trying to please people. As children, we try to please our parents, our teachers. As parents, I think somewhat we try to please our children. At least give them food they like to eat every once in a while. For most of us, we try to please our friends, at least enough to keep them as friends. As employees, we try to please our bosses. And if none of this sounds familiar to you or think it doesn't apply to you, well, then I feel certain, like everyone else, you spend a great deal of time trying to do what is pleasing for yourself. Today's passage from Galatians is autobiographical for the most part. It is Paul's testimony, his personal story of coming to faith in Christ and those early days that followed his conversion. But in this letter, this testimony is serving a bigger purpose. You will remember that the cause of this letter is that certain teachers had come from the church in Jerusalem to the churches in Galatia. And they had begun to teach these Gentile Christians that in order to truly be Christians, in order to be saved, they needed to become observant Jews. They had to be circumcised. They had to observe the dietary and ceremonial laws of the Mosaic Covenant. And we call this group Judaizers. The implications of what Paul writes is that this group, they had either sort of a nationalistic or xenophobic motivation, or they were pragmatic, self-serving in what they were teaching. So these Jerusalem Christians were either trying to please their own sense of cultural identity by wanting to make the Gentiles good Jews, right? Be like us. Or they were trying to appease non-Christian Jews who were hostile to the Christian message by appearing to uphold traditional Jewish customs and Jewish teaching, right? So one or the other. Like, ooh, Gentiles are weird, you need to be more like us Jews, or things are pretty rough here, so why don't we just act like we're just like all the other Jews and maybe they'll kind of leave us alone if we just seem to be telling people to do the same thing with just a little bit of this Jesus thrown in. They were altering the gospel message in this, either from a desire to make others conform to their Jewish cultural expectations or to appease Jewish religious leaders. Either way, the gospel was being altered. In either way, they were trying to please human beings, either themselves or Jewish religious leaders. But who is Paul trying to please in all of this? Rhetorically, he asked that very question of his readers. And he will answer that by addressing another question, which these Judaizers have raised. Whose gospel is it that Paul preaches? Well, Paul answers that forthrightly. Verse 11, "For I would have you know, brothers, that the gospel that was preached by me is not man's gospel." That is, the gospel that I'm preaching does not originate with humanity in any way, shape, form, or fashion, other than the fact that it was God the Son in human flesh who proclaimed this gospel. But it originates in heaven in that sense, not from any of us as mere mortals. So first, in declaring or trying to explain this in this part of his testimony, Paul is going to say that the gospel, it isn't a gospel of the Jewish religious leaders. Most notably, I would say the Pharisees here. Paul isn't preaching a gospel which is pleasing to those under whom he grew up and under whom he studied. Paul himself had been a Pharisee, quite a good Pharisee. But the gospel doesn't come from that. He didn't come to his understanding of the gospel through his own reasoning. He didn't sit around and sort of think this through. Up until his conversion, he was extremely hostile to the gospel message. He persecuted the church violently, even trying to destroy it, as he says in verse 13. Wasn't it? This was kind of a long, drawn-out process of reflection. He didn't spend months researching this whole thing. Paul had in fact heard Christian preachers and messages. He had been present when Stephen delivered a very powerful sermon of conviction, culminating in the hope that we have in Christ. And then Paul watched with approval, Luke tells us in Acts 8. He watched with approval as Stephen was stoned to death. And from there, Paul simply goes on to systematically try to destroy Christianity. So rather than it being this sort of thing like, well, you know, I heard it and I kind of really was thinking about it and everything. No, Paul was one day persecuting the church, and then the next day he was a follower of Jesus. What had happened? He had had a direct encounter with the risen Lord. I mean, even the men who were traveling with him had heard the voice of the Lord there on the road to Damascus. And so, first sense, Paul didn't come up with this gospel message in order to please his Jewish teachers or his Jewish colleagues, his Pharisee colleagues. Instead, it came from the Lord. The Lord had made him a follower, and the Lord had made him an apostle, a preacher of this message. Nor was this gospel message something taught to him by other Christian leaders. He didn't go to Jerusalem in order to learn the gospel. And so he does not preach that gospel in order to please the Christian leaders who had taught him this, whether they be in Antioch or even more importantly in the church of Jerusalem. Listen again to how he describes his early days in the faith, starting with the second part of verse 16. "I did not immediately consult with anyone, nor did I go up to Jerusalem to those who were apostles before me. But I went away into Arabia and returned again to Damascus." In fact, it was 3 years. 3 years before Paul went back to Jerusalem, as he tells us in verse 18. And once there, he only meets with Peter and James, the brother of Jesus. And he doesn't stay for some prolonged period in which he is kind of undergoes some great training or discipleship program. He's there all of 15 days in Jerusalem. He doesn't meet any of the other apostles. One of the attacks against Paul appears to be that he had actually received the gospel message from those in Jerusalem, but he didn't get the whole story. And therefore, these other teachers had to come in and they had to sort of complete it for the Galatians. They had to fill them in on what all was required of them because Paul had left out part of this. If that were the case, then Paul would be accountable to the leaders in Jerusalem. He would need to please them and allow these other teachers to finish what he had started. But that's not how Paul received the gospel message. He doesn't need to please the ones in Jerusalem. Instead, he needs to please the one who gave him the message itself. Not church leaders, but Jesus. The third aspect that we see here of how Paul got this message, or where it comes from, is it's not a gospel of self-interest. That is, he didn't simply come up with a message in order to make himself happy. Paul is a great example of this. Paul goes from being a persecutor of the church to being someone who is persecuted, who is stoned, who is driven out of town, who is imprisoned. Why? Because of the very message he preaches. He doesn't come up with this as a way to be happy, as a way to find fulfillment. This is sort of the other side of Paul's visit to Jerusalem. Though he didn't receive the gospel message from those at the mother church, it was nevertheless validated by those in Jerusalem, as well as those in the regions of Syria and Cilicia. Why can we say that? Because Paul affirms that it was Christians in those places that glorified God on account of what the Lord had done in Paul's life. You see what he's saying? Is that I didn't come up with this because of the teachers that I had when I was a young person. They didn't give me this gospel. I didn't go to Jerusalem and get this gospel message, nor did I come up with this simply to make myself feel better or to promote myself. In fact, this gospel message so corresponds with what the people in Jerusalem were teaching and in these other places where Christianity already was, that they glorified God because of what they had heard had happened to me and what I was proclaiming. It's a very different thing than self-interest or pleasing his own desires. Paul is glorifying God. And so, he doesn't fear the Pharisees and the Jewish religious leaders. He doesn't desire to please them. He doesn't fear the church leaders. He wasn't commissioned by them. And he doesn't even fear for his own reputation or his self-interest or his own life. Paul fears only God. And therefore his goal is to seek the glorification of God. And I think we see this in his very testimony. The very way he recounts his whole story. Paul was a sinner. He's no saving face here. He violently persecuted the church of God and sought to destroy it. Those are Paul's words, right? He's not like, you know, I was a pretty decent fella. Going along helping people and suddenly I realized I needed a little bit more. No, I was trying to destroy the very thing that God was doing. I was in a bad place. I am a sinner. That very confession, part of the gospel, is offensive to a great many people. It displeases a great many. Because the gospel starts with this reality. We are all sinners. It demands that we come clean with ourselves and with God. Just like Paul, we can't save face. We also see with Paul that all our good deeds cannot save us. Paul was extremely zealous for moral righteousness. He followed all the traditions and the regulations that he could. But it didn't make him right with God, did it? I mean, this is what Paul's saying to, it's like, I was so on fire for human tradition. I was doing it all. I was working hard at it. It is, in essence, what Paul is saying to what the Judaizers are telling the Galatians. Paul's saying, been there, done that, didn't work for me. I tried that, and I never could live up to it. I kept coming up short no matter what. He needed a rescuer. We all need a rescuer. We cannot make ourselves right with God no matter how hard we work at it. And then here's the hope. Because Paul is a trophy of God's grace. Despite all his violence, his hatred toward what God was doing, the Lord saved Paul. Not only that, but the Lord made Paul a preacher, an apostle of the very message that Paul was trying to stamp out. The message of grace, and that is the radical nature of the gospel. Jesus didn't wait on Paul to come around. He didn't want him to mellow out or to get better. Jesus intervened and he saved Paul in and from the mess of his rebellious life right then, right there. As religious as he was, he still needed salvation. By the standard of his culture and his traditions, Paul was a very good religious man. But his testimony is he still needed the grace of God. By the standards of God, Paul was very bad. He was a terrible sinner. Why? He was actively trying to destroy what God was doing. But that did not put him beyond God's grace, did it? What can we glean from this passage? I think we should examine our lives, our motivations, our underlying motivations. Ask ourselves, who are we trying to please? Who are we trying to please? The question isn't whether we should be winsome or not, whether we should, you know, go out and act like a jerk or be polite. That's not what this question is about. The question is, what is the motivation of our actions? What is our ultimate goal? Is it to please others, to please ourselves, or is it to please God? In pleasing God, we may please others or we may not. The deciding factor is, does this glorify God? Does this please God? Are we afraid to insult? Are we afraid to look bad in the eyes of our culture, of our friends, of our neighbors, our family? Do we live in fear of what others will think? Jesus teaches us to fear only God. And that is what we see in Paul's life as he writes to the Galatians. He knows he is accountable to God, to God alone, for all things, from the life that he lives to the message he preaches. And I think we too should live a life founded upon the fear of the Lord. That is what pleases God. That fear is not cowering in a corner, afraid of what God will say or do. The fear of the Lord, doing what pleases God, starts with this very thing, accepting His grace, accepting this wonderful gift that He has given us in Christ Jesus. That takes us from the corner of fear and moves us into right standing with God. The simple acceptance. Faith. Faith that in Christ we have forgiveness. We can be in right standing with God forever. From accepting that grace comes appreciation, joy, delight, reverence and respect, hope, a yearning to see and to know the glory of God in ourselves and in others. And that's what it means to fear the Lord and to fear Him alone. This is what we find in Paul. Because you see, he's not simply a preacher of the gospel. He's a product of the gospel. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. This is the pattern of our worship, isn't it? God speaks, we respond. God calls, we come with praise and thanksgiving. God greets us, and we in turn greet one another. God's word comes to us, and we know we stand as sinners, and we confess, and God offers us grace and forgiveness. God has spoken his word to us now, and we still must respond. We must be doers of this word and not hearers only. So let us take a moment and commit to be those doers of his word. We respond in faith. And that faith is focused on Christ. It has substance. And so let's stand and affirm our faith together. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. As we continue to respond, we're going to sing hymn number 395, God of Grace and God of Glory.
Thank you.
opportunities for the week and some thanks for last week. We thank you for your prayers, your donations, and all the efforts that were made for a successful Vacation Bible School. I think it was reported in the bulletin that we registered 62 people or children, and then we had an additional 25 to 30-ish workers, so close to 100 people. They may have been. We have a deacon's meeting this morning, following Sunday school, beginning approximately 11:30, and then the Meals on Wheels sign-up for August is on the table down here if you are interested in signing up. There's going to be a supper club with the Presbyterians on Friday at 6:30 at Milano's. You are invited to join them, or we are invited to join them.
And there's a sign-up sheet here on the Lord's table.
Okay.
And in the Sunday
class. Okay. Sign-up sheets for reservations for that, and that will be 26, when you say it, seems like a long time away, but that's just this Friday. And then choir will practice also at 11:30. So those that are not in the deacon's meetings, if you can join Randall in the choir room, he would appreciate it. Oh, sorry, in the sanctuary, yes. Sorry, he did say that. My bad. Anything else? Okay.
As we come forward for our time of prayer and dismissal, tomorrow is Pal's birthday, and the flowers here are in honor of Pal's birthday. I think, Pal, this is one you can brag about. How old are you going to be?
93.
93. See, that's... I'm not sure at what point you get to start bragging, but that's clearly there to give thanks for 93 wonderful years. That may be the best, not bragging, but giving public thanks, right? All right, does anybody have any other prayer requests they'd like to share with us at this time?
I have a cousin, Grant May Jr. He's Carol May's brother. You know, she just lost her father this past year. He's got colon cancer. He's in Birmingham. I'd like to ask for him and her.
Dr. Fernandez, a pediatrician, died this morning. Mm-hmm. And so I saw the hearse go by when I went outside.
Yeah, we do want to continue to remember Didar and his family and the fire that they experienced last week. Howard and Suzanne. Bill and Ann.
My brother.
Yes, Ronnie recovering from heart surgery. And when's he going to get to come home? Do they? Okay.
I have a praise. Yes. Rhonda Richardson had a PET scan, and they are showing no detectable tumors.
Wonderful.
So she's strictly on Keytruda currently.
Can we plug the front for a different?
Yeah. I think that's acceptable. Yeah.
Going back to y'all again.
My dad has shingles all over his face and his eyes very swollen. Pray that it doesn't get in his eye.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, she said, my father-in-law has shingles all over his face, or half of his face, right?
Yeah.
Dance, yep, we'll continue to remember Dance and his recovery. All right, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we thank you for your goodness to us. We thank you for this good news that we have had from Rhonda's life. We thank you for your care over Ronnie and this surgery and seeing Dance through his surgery. We ask for your continued strength and care for healing for them. We ask that you continue to uphold Howard and Suzanne and Bill and Ann, and Pat and Richard, Roger and Jane, and Pat and Lamar. Jackie, Carolyn, Vi. We ask, Father, for your grace to be multiplied in their lives. We pray especially for Dedar and his family in this difficult time. May they experience your love through us in caring for them. For Grant and this cancer, as well as for Joy, we pray, Father, that you would strengthen them as you prepare them for the eternal weight of glory. These are difficult things for us to understand, yet your purposes are at work in their lives, we know. We pray for the Fernandez family that you would comfort them in this time of loss. Hear us now, Father, as we offer our prayers to you.
Lord, I want to give you thanks for this week in Vacation Bible School, Lord. We had some active little children and we had some good times. But Lord, even though sometimes you would think they weren't listening to Miss Jerry's stories or the words to the songs, they would surprise you and they would surprise us and amaze us with the answers they would give. Lord, the seeds have been planted. Seeds were already planted in many of those. Lord, I hope we just watered those seeds and that somehow or another this week of Vacation Bible School helped them to know you better. Thank you for this week.
Dear Father, I lift up to you this morning a group of people that we've gotten to know. They graduated yesterday from a program where they've been involved in addictions, and they've gotten to know Jesus and know that Jesus is the only answer for them. And I just pray for them now as they leave those places where they've been for a year and all those wonderful teachers and people they've been around who've helped to keep them safe, and that you guide them and bless them as they get out into life and keep them close to you.
Father, hear us now as we pray the words our Lord has taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Remember this word, brothers and sisters. But even if you should suffer for righteousness' sake, you will be blessed. Have no fear of them, nor be troubled, but in your hearts honor Christ the Lord as holy, always being prepared to make a defense to anyone who asks you for a reason for the hope that is in you. Yet do it with gentleness and respect. And may the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, so that by the power of the Holy Spirit you may abound in hope. Amen. Go in peace.